Watercolour painting for beginners. Now this video will teach you step by step how to add a very easy watercolour background. Now the suggestion of sky, plants and ground will really showcase your watercolour paintings, and it makes them look a little bit more grounded, just as if it's part of the actual landscape as well. Welcome to my channel. My name is Paul Hopkinson. I'm an online art tutor teaching realistic wildlife, both animals and plants, in watercolour. Right, the first thing we need to do is put a little bit of water in our palette, which I've already got a little bit in there now, and spray the half pans as well, ready to go. What I'm thinking about the background is like a multi-variegated wash, from starting from one colour to the next and to the next and all the way down to a kind of faded colour at the bottom. So what I mean by that, we'll pick out some intense blue, which is phthalo blue, if you remember, okay. We'll just do a little bit to begin with, just to test it out. So intense blue, and I think a little bit of olive green as well. Just try this out first. I don't want to use too much paint to begin with. Then, let's have a quick look. So we'll go for some burnt sienna. So that can pop into there. All right, a bit of burnt sienna. And I think that might be about it. Should we go for a little bit of burnt umber? Yeah, okay. A little bit of burnt umber as well. There's not much left in my half pans here. What I tend to do with these, by the way, very often get some quality paint, either Winsor & Newton students or the professional versions, and squeeze them into my half pans. They don't last quite as long as when you buy the half pans because they're very concentrated normally. But so it just saves having to keep replacing them, that's all. Right, that should be plenty. We've got four colours. I tend to have no more than three or four colours for a background because otherwise it gets a little bit too complicated. We may not even use a brown yet. We'll just see how it goes. So, some test paper, as you can see. Let's get my size 5 brush. I'm going to wet this down first of all. So it's going to all cockle and curl because I haven't got it taped down or anything like that. Just so we can test it out really, more than anything. So start off with the phthalo blue, or intense blue, whichever you want to call it. Imagine this being the background for the meerkat. And I think I might just water that down a little bit more. Oh, that is intense. Oh, yeah, okay. Wash your brush out, get some olive green, and start down below and bring it up into that. If you want to add some more, wash the brush out first whilst you end up pulling the blue down. It depends how you want it to look, really. Then we're going to go for the burnt sienna. Blend it in. Start from the bottom, work your way up. And we can try a little bit of burnt umber in there as well, just so it kind of varies the colour in there. So that's the idea for the background, really. As simple as that. We don't want it too intense, so we may even have it paler than this yet. Bearing in mind that watercolour always dries a little bit lighter. Some people say about 20% lighter. So it depends on the consistency of paint, obviously, really, to be honest with you. But that gives some ideas. So if we have it paler at the top like that, that might work better. So that's what we're looking for kind of rough, kind of variegated, multi-variegated background wash. Just for a bit of fun, really. So what you can do when it's nearly dry, you get some burnt umber. Okay, this is another mock-up of the same thing we've just been doing. And you can add details in, just in the foreground. So you can imagine grass stems, anything like that, gradually getting smaller as they go in towards the background. And all you need to use is a very fine detailed brush. Anything with a good point on it, really. And then that can be added into the background details. But you can also, if you wanted to, get a little bit of kitchen roll, preferably clean, not one like this. So I'll just tear some of that off. Crunch it up like that, okay? And then, when it's still damp though, it's probably a little bit too dry now, you can do that over the top. So it's just pulling a little bit of paint off, as you can see here, look. Just create like a very light cloud effect. Now the wetter it is, the more paint it will obviously pull off. So just bear that in mind if you wanted to try anything like this. But keep changing the shape of the tissue roll or tissue paper you've got, because then you get different effects at the same time. So here's some ideas, the kind of things you can add on if you want to. Now, if you're enjoying this watercolour painting for beginners video and my step-by-step guide to adding an easy watercolour background, could you do me a favour as well and click on like, subscribe, share and also comment down below as well. Because all these interactions encourage YouTube to show my content to even more people. And in turn, this will allow my channel to grow and teach even more budding artists like yourself.
Now, what I envisage is to get the blue coming down probably to about here and then probably about two-thirds of the way down, then add the green in. Then we'll add the burnt sienna and probably a little bit of burnt umber mixed in with that. But say, don't have it too intense. So even though the colours I've got in my palette here ready to go, these are quite watery. In fact, they're very watery. We can even add a little bit more water to them if need be, just to make sure that they're not too thick. And if they are too thick, don't worry. We'll just get our brush again, your big brush, and then lift off that water and that paint just to soften it down and lighten that a little bit more. Right, the first thing we need to do is get the background nice and wet. I'm going to do this two or three times just to make sure that the water soaks into the paper and the paper will stay wet enough, long enough, to kind of add the colours over the top. Because the problem is if you just wet it once, it will dry far too quickly and you'll be fighting time, drying time, trying to get the colours on there. So wet it two or three times, allow the water to soak into the paper, to say. I'm going to use a mop brush, which is a 1-inch one, and this is a very old size 18 Pro Art brush. In fact, I used to have a tip on that once upon a time, but not anymore. That's how I've had it for quite a few years. I never use it for applying backgrounds anyway. So that's what I use. So the first thing to do is wet the background. Obviously, don't wet inside the meerkat itself. Just wet the background, and say do this two or three times. And you'll see how wet this is in a minute when I show you. Right into the corners. You tend to find that when you do wet the backgrounds as well, is that's usually around the edges, the very edges, the perimeter, where it will dry quickest. It will dry the fastest, if you know what I mean. So bear that in mind as well. I suppose that's going towards the edge of the paper where it will dry quicker. And you can lightly tease it into the paper if you want to, into the nap of the paper. But I like it to soak in, really. Don't like to encourage it too much because I don't want to ruin the paper itself, because the paper's got what's called a sizing on it. So it kind of prevents it from being like a blotting paper at the end of the day. So you don't want to take that sizing off. Now this is quite wet, as you can see here. That's how wet it is. Okay, so really soaking wet at the moment. I want to allow this to kind of soak in that little bit. Make sure I've got right to the edge of the meerkat over this masking fluid. And then I'll put another two washes over the top. Right, so that should be it. That's about three layers of water on there. And it's soaked in quite well, actually, on this paper. And this is that Bockingford paper, as I say, so it just won't work quite well. And you can still see it's got a shine on there, nice and shiny, but it's not running down the paper like a waterfall. Okay, so the next thing we need to do is get the colours on while it's nice and damp. So I'm going to dampen my brush out, first of all, my old size 18. I want to start from the top, so I'm just going to shift myself to one side a little bit. I'm going to start right from the very top using the phthalo blue, or intense blue, same colour. But I want to start off a little bit lighter to begin with, and then go a little bit darker, more intense as it comes down, is what I'm thinking of. I'm trying to think horizontal as well. I don't want it too dark, I want it nice and pale, really. Quite pastely at the end of the day is what I'm looking for. Alright. Then as it comes down, probably to about there, we want it to start to get a little bit more intense, so we'll add a bit more paint in there as we go along. Remember, we want the blue to come down to about here, roughly. So, remember, about there. And a little bit more. Let's get a bit more intense there now. This will mingle, it will blend as it goes along.
Now please click on subscribe down below and remember to press that bell icon as well, because when you press that bell icon, YouTube should let you know when I put a brand new video on here for you to watch.
Now I'm going to go straight into the olive green. You've got to remember that you're working with time on this, with drying times, so you don't want to spend too long doing a background. So you want to do this within the space of a couple of minutes or something like that, preferably. Okay, so olive green, just down the side here. Try and keep it sort of in a level with the other side. A bit more down there, so I've picked up some blue there. there. Alright, just further down. So I'm not going back to the top of the paper now, that's starting to dry. Then I'm going to go into the burnt sienna. Start adding that in. Going to mix in the olive green. Just down to the bottom. This is why having a reasonable sized brush does help, because it covers an area very quickly. Especially when you know you've got to fight drying times and stuff like that. So you've got to really think ahead before you make a start. And I'm going to go with a little bit of burnt umber. Just to kind of vary the very end, the very bottom. A bit more actually in there. So I've got far too much paint mixed up already. But it's more water than paint, to be honest with you. There's a tiny little mark on there. I'm going to leave that. If I try picking that off now, it could leave a blemish on the paper. I'd rather have that mark on there than a big blemish there. The last thing I like to do around the edge of the paper, just get a bit of kitchen roll. The paint's out of the way. And then very lightly, just use the edge of the kitchen roll, barely touching the paper, though, do it very lightly, as I say. Just take off that surplus paint. Just kind of neatens it out a little bit. Right, so it's nice and dry. Left it for a few hours now. And you can see that it's gone lovely and flat. Now, look in the description down below and you see my website link. When you go there, you can sign up as a free member and gain access to 2 real-time videos on how to paint a robin and a bee eater in watercolour. Now let me know in the comments down below if you found my video useful. But also, do you add watercolour backgrounds to your wildlife paintings? Let me know, I'd love to hear from you. Now have a look to my right where you see my meerkat video and you'll be able to see how I created that right from the beginning all the way through to the end.